Yes, you can speak, Mr.
Finance Speaker, sir. I rise, sir, to present an interim budget for the part of the fiscal year 2004-2005. This seeks a vote on account to enable the government to discharge its responsibilities and to meet all essential expenditure during the first 4 months of 2004-2005. The demands for grants and the annual financial statement presented are, however, for the full financial year, though these could be revised, as is normal, at the time of the presentation of the regular budget. I am also introducing, sir, a finance bill seeking to continue the existing tax structure for the present. Sir, under the premiership of Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, this is the seventh successive budget of the government of the National Democratic Alliance. Sir, on this occasion, I share with the country and the House a sense of great satisfaction at the robust showing of our national economy, and also express our sincere gratitude for the cooperation, support, and encouragement that the people of India have so consistently and so ungrudgingly given to the NDA to and to its government. So the country's macroeconomic situation is better than it has ever been in the last 50 years. Internationally, too, there is now much greater and a much more widespread recognition that India is progressing in all spheres of national endeavor, that it has evolved into a stable economy with assured growth and enhanced national prosperity. So this government has consistently placed the citizens' well-being at the core of its responsibilities. Our adherence to 5 priorities remains. The objectives of the lifetime concerns of our citizens: enhanced employment and eradication of poverty, a second green revolution in agriculture, infrastructure development, fiscal consolidation, and greater manufacturing sector efficiency are our solemn commitments. We believe, sir, that both are necessary. A vision for a resurgent India and simultaneously an awakening so that the disadvantaged of our land are lifted beyond poverty. We hold that economic development is not about economics alone. It is always simultaneously a political statement too. For development devoid of compassion is a misnomer. Of course, growth statistics are very important. They are vital inputs, but they must also be the indices that assist us in designing distributive justice. It is for this reason that gross national contentment is so important as the catalyst that motivates redoubled national endeavor. It is from seeking national contentment that objectives are born. Gareeb ke pet mein dana, Grihini ki tukhiya mein aana. Sir, India must be amongst the leading economies of the world. That, simply put, is our national destiny. To be in service of the country's destiny is the government's honor and its bounden duty. From this directly flow our national economic objectives. So economic growth indices in the current year, Mr. Speaker, are very encouraging. With inflation at 4 to 4.5%, this year we expect the growth rate of our GDP to be between 7.5% and 8%. Speaker Sahib, yahan main aapse nivedan karna chahunga. Kuch satra pehle isi sadan mein एक माननीय मुंगेरी लाल जी का जिक्र हुआ था, तो फिर हमने मुंगेरी लाल जी की तलाश की, उनकी सूची में वो उनका नाम मिला नहीं, तो निवेदन है कि आप माननीय मुंगेरी लाल जी को अगर इतला करा सकें कि उनके सुनहरे सपने साकार हो गए हैं, आपका आभार है। So those are our higher growth estimates that have been made. So those are our higher growth estimates that have been made. For the present, we prefer to remain. I wish to repeat, sir, that though there are higher growth estimates that have been made, for the present, we prefer to remain with the figures that I have cited. But this level of growth, sir, is a matter of great satisfaction. I also wish to emphasize here, sir, that employment has increased, but so have expectations. And the government must meet this challenge and on a continuous basis. Bold initiatives in infrastructure have already generated several layers of immediate employment, simultaneously laying the foundation for additional quality employment across a broad spectrum of economic activity. The objective of enhancing job opportunities will be pursued vigorously. Our foreign exchange reserve crossed US$100 billion on December 19, 2003. They continue to grow, liberating us from the mentality of want. For greater openness and to share necessary information with citizens, the first ever report of the Reserve Bank of India on foreign exchange reserves is being released today. It can be accessed on the Ministry of Finances as well as the Reserve Bank's website from today onwards. So the combination of moderate inflation, declining interest rates, and healthy capital markets have set our economy on the path of accelerated growth. To further encourage this is our responsibility. Preserving the strength of our macroeconomic fundamentals has therefore to be much more focused. Management of the economy, sir, is a continuing responsibility. Governance can neither pause nor cease, and measures to fully consolidate and continuously enhance the growth momentum must always be adopted in time. Only in that manner can we realize the vision of economic and social progress that we have cherished since independence. Amongst the reform measures that I wish to announce, first is Antyodaya Anna Yojana. It was launched by the Prime Minister in December 2000, and it currently covers 1.5 crore families below the poverty line. This is a highly successful program, widely acclaimed. It directly addresses poverty alleviation and nutritional adequacy. This program is now being extended by increasing its coverage to 2 crore BPL families. Whilst doing so, it will be assured that tribal states, districts, or belts receive added allocation. This program will be effective from April 1, 2004. Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana. Poverty and disease, sir, are interlinked. Specialty hospitals in the private sector remain beyond the reach of many of our citizens. The Prime Minister had therefore last Independence Day announced the establishing of 6 hospitals in the government sector on the pattern of All India Institute of Medical Sciences. This Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana envisages 6 new AIIMS-like hospitals, one each in the states of Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa, Rajasthan, and Uttaranchal. Honourable members are doubtless aware that no additional hospital on the pattern of AIIMS has been set up by any government since 1956. I would also like to mention that under the Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana, one medical college in the six states of Andhra Pradesh, Jammu Kashmir, Jharkhand, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, and West Bengal will also be upgraded to the level of AIIML. I'm happy to announce, sir, that provisions for both these schemes have been made in this budget itself. Rural. So the government is committed to ensuring the availability of timely credit at affordable rates to our farmers and to other citizens in rural India. For this objective, the following additional measures will be taken. So in July of 2003, a reduction in the rate of interest for crop loans by the public sector banks to 9% was announced for the farming sector. NABARD Act was also appropriately amended. I've been urging the Indian Banks Association to further lower the interest rates for agriculture purposes. Some public sector banks have already done so, and I'm confident, sir, when I say and announce here that other banks will also respond by offering loans at rates lower than these prevailing currently for the agriculture sector. The other aspect, sir, is that traditionally banks have sought relatively higher security for credit on credit for agriculture. To illustrate, banks insist on mortgaging the entire landholding of a farmer borrower as security for advances for agriculture purposes. Banks are now therefore being advised to assess individual creditworthiness and not routinely insist on additional collateral through a mortgage of the entire land holding. As a principle, the banks have been advised that collateral security should be proportionate to the value of the loan, and prescriptions relating to non-performing assets in relation to crop loan accounts have posed problems in the governing and the provisioning of credit to farmers, where seasonality and uncertainty of farm incomes are not fully captured. A committee has therefore been set up under Dr. V.S. Vyas, an eminent agriculture economist, to address this issue. Suitable remedial measures in this regard will be recommended by this committee within 90 days. I further expect, sir, that all eligible farmers will be in receipt of their Kisan credit cards by March 31st, 2004. To extend the benefit of technological developments in banking industry to rural India, the existing Kisan credit card will hereafter be modified upon individual request for use on ATM machines wherever such facility exists. A farm income insurance scheme has been introduced by the Ministry of Agriculture in 20 districts on a pilot basis. This will be extended to 100 districts of the country from the forthcoming Kharif season. Details will be announced shortly by the Ministry of Agriculture. Self-help groups, sir, have been a remarkable success story, but only in some states of the country. NABARD has therefore been advised to take up a special promotional campaign in the states where this program is yet to gather momentum. In the first phase, an intensive program will therefore be launched in the states of Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Madhya Pradesh. Public sector banks will also supplement this effort in other states. So I now come to tea. It's a very important agro-processing industry employing a large number of our citizens in North Bengal, Assam, the Northeast, and some of the southern states. Currently, this industry is beset by many problems. I had therefore tasked the Indian Banks Association to prepare a revival package. This has now been finalized. Special T-term loan, repayable in 5 years, with a moratorium of 1 year shall be provided. In case of small tea growers, banks have agreed to extend fresh working capital limits up to rupees 2 lakh at an interest of 9% only. In addition, sir, steps will be undertaken to examine the feasibility of a debt amelioration scheme in the tea sector also. So sugar is another major agro-processing industry of the country, generating substantial employment, but it currently faces a complex web of problems. Government will therefore prepare a package for the revitalization of this industry in consultation with all the stakeholders. In the meantime, as a measure of temporary relief, restructuring of loans taken by sugar factories will be examined by the lending agencies, including banks, in consultation with RBI and NABARD. Cooperative banks, sir, have always played a vital role in the delivery of rural credit. They too have a variety of problems hampering their capacity to deliver credit at reasonable rates of interest. A scheme to revitalize the cooperative credit sector envisaging an outlay of about rupees 15,000 crore to be shared between the centers and state governments in an appropriate ratio has been prepared. It is proposed to initiate this important scheme as soon as the revised regulatory framework has been put in place. Sir, cattle development, cattle are a vital integral of our rural economy, and to give a boost to the entire gamut of this economic activity, such as animal husbandry, dairying, and sheep rearing, the government will examine the setting up of a National Cattle Development Board with appropriate budgetary support. Sir, about Lagu Udyami credit cards. To further encourage the development of small-scale and self-employed ventures, steps have been taken to liberalize Lagu Udyami credit card scheme, providing small and medium enterprises easier access to bank credit. It has now been decided in consultation with IBA that public sector banks will increase the credit limit of their cards for borrowers with satisfactory track record from the present rupees 2 lakhs to rupees 10 lakhs. Banks are being advised to make the modified scheme operational from 1st of March 2004. Stamp duty. Sir, a comprehensive reform of the entire stamp duty regime is being addressed in consultation with the state governments. As high stamp duty increases transaction costs and restricts economic activity, the government has, in the meantime, decided to reduce stamp duty on all such instruments where the authority to fix rates is of the central government. As a first step and as the first reduction, the existing stamp duty structure is being halved, that is being reduced by 50% of all stamp central government stamp paper. As for duty on receipts, here too the threshold of payment of stamp duty is to be increased from the current rupees 500 to rupees 50,000. As however, this last reform requires an amendment to the Act, it will be operational after the Act has been amended. The government has decided to make announcements, sir, about certain special areas. Firstly, the island territories. The district of Nicobar in the Andamans and Nicobar Islands is one of our remotest districts. These islands, separated by vast distances across the sea, are relatively inaccessible. Therefore, in the Nicobar group of islands, a hard area allowance at the rate of 25% of basic pay will, with effect from April 1, 2004, be paid to all government employees posted there. So, due to high cost of construction,
please keep quiet now.
So, due to high cost of construction, consequently high rentals prevailing in this region, and as directed by the Prime Minister, it has been decided that the status of Port Blair be raised from a C to a B1 class city for the purpose of house rent allowance. Simultaneously, rural areas of the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands and the entire Union Territory of Lakshadweep will also stand upgraded from their existing status of unclassified to C-class city for the purpose of the payment of this allowance. Consequently, HRA will also be raised from the present 7.5% to 15% of the basic pay in all other areas of the Union Territories of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, as well as the Union Territory of Lakshadweep. Simultaneously, sir, the status of the state of Goa is also being raised from C to B1 from April 1, 2004, for the purpose of HRA. Sir, I do come from the desert of the country, but this is not why the announcement is being made here. The desert areas of the country are under a variety of stresses. Most of them are also either border districts or are contiguous to it. Last year had been announced the Maru Gochar Yojana, a special program for rehabilitation and development of traditional pasture lands in the desert districts of Rajasthan. I am glad to inform the honorable members that the implementation of this program has started. So I now propose to establish a task force for integrated development of desert areas with a mandate to address the problems of sustainable livelihood in our deserts. This task force will review all relevant current programs, identify gaps, define thrust areas, and make appropriate recommendations. It will also examine the establishment of a rural technology center in one of the desert districts and give its recommendation in this regard. The Indira Gandhi Canal project has languished for decades, slowly inching its way year after year through the desert. Considering the inordinate delay in the completion and the critical importance of water in our desert areas, this canal project will hereafter be accelerated through a fresh center-state initiative, including additional innovative funding. Similarly, for an extension into Rajasthan of the Narmada Canal too, the Ministry of Finance will work with the government of Rajasthan and assist it in financing an early completion. Kutch and adjoining districts, at present new industrial units in the Kutch districts of Gujarat, established during the period July 31, 2001 to July 31, 2004, and will start commercial production on or before July 31st, 2004, are exempt from excise duty. In order to give some more time for completion of such projects, I'm extending the last date for setting up such units from July 31st, 2004 to December 31, 2004. The period of exemption from excise duty will continue to be 5 years from the date of start of commercial production. Water scarcity in some of our metropolitan cities, Several initiatives, sir, have been taken by the government to address the vital question of providing an assured supply of potable water to rural India. Metropolitan cities have until now had to address this shortage through either their own municipal resources or on the strength of support received from the respective state governments. The need and demand for water has grown much faster than additional supply measures. The Prime Minister has therefore directed and decided to initiate an accelerated drinking water supply scheme for mega cities such as Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, and Hyderabad. The provision such as
भाषण करते समय
आप पानी पीने को नहीं
करते जब आपकी टर्न आएगी भाषण करते समय आप जरूर बोलेंगे
I have said such as
रामलाल जी
I have said such as उसका अर्थ है उदाहरण The provision for existing central scheme for infrastructure development in mega cities will be augmented by accessing the infrastructure fund, life insurance corporation, and other such other funding sources. Details will be initiated and finalized by the Ministry of Finance to ensure that the scheme is operational by 1st March 2004. Sir, the convention centres had been decided upon last year. The government has now decided upon the venues of these four global standard international convention centres to be established through private-public partnership. I am glad, sir, that two of these will be located in the metropolitan cities of Delhi and Mumbai. And one each in Goa and Rajasthan. Both Goa and Rajasthan have great tourism potential, but need more infrastructure facilities. Goa will thus also be able to provide suitable facilities for holding international film festivals, so that the convention center in Jaipur functions effectively. The airport in Jaipur will be converted into an international airport. Details of all these will be announced shortly. On development finance, there is no alternative to it. Steps to revive and restructure the Industrial Development of India are already in hand. In accordance with the mandate of the Parliament, the Ministry of Finance is committed to preserving and strengthening the IDBI's role as a development financial institution. The current economic growth pattern requires continuous and added investment. For this, finance has to be made available timely, at reasonable rates, and in a coordinated manner. Since the restructured IDBI has the requisite experience and expertise, project appraisal, funding, and coordination, it has been decided to designate the IDBI as the lead developmental finance institution. Government will provide necessary support to the IDBI for this task. IDBI's efforts will be complemented by other premier institutions and banks, such as the Infrastructure Development Finance Corporation and the State Bank of India. Similarly, the Industrial Finance Corporation of India, IFCI, will be restructured to transfer of its impaired assets to an asset reconstruction company and merger with a large public sector bank. Both these institutions, the IDBI and IFCI, should be functional in the new financial year after their transformation. So other schemes, the Agriculture Infrastructure and Credit Fund, the Small and Medium Enterprise Fund, and the Industrial Infrastructure Fund will be operational shortly. All the three funds will, without compromising the norms of financial prudence, provide credit at highly competitive rates, which is expected to be 2 percentage points below the prime lending rate. I wish to reiterate that the Agriculture Infrastructure and Credit Fund will provide credit support to infrastructure facilities such as wasteland development, completion of existing but incomplete minor irrigation projects, plus new minor irrigation works, grading, certification, and storage of agro products, and construction of modern abattoirs. This fund will be called Lok Nayak Jai Prakash Narayan Fund. Similarly, the Small and Medium Enterprise Fund will address the problems of inadequacy of financial resources at the highly competitive rates for the small-scale sector and a lack of SIDBI coverage for some of the medium-sized enterprises. Industrial Infrastructure Fund will also provide credit at highly competitive rates for power generation, seaports, airports, roads, tourism, telecommunication, and urban infrastructure like municipal services, water supply, sewage disposal, and environment projects. Defense Modernization Fund. The process of defense procurement often extends to over 3 years. Adequate and a committed availability of funds over such a period for defense modernization and weapons systems acquisition needs a satisfactory resolution. It has accordingly been decided to establish a non-lapsable defense modernization fund of ₹25,000 crore. This will commit availability of adequate funds for the purpose. This fund will be made available to the Ministry of Defense from the new financial year. Employee welfare, sir. The fifth Central Pay Commission had recommended that the Dearness Allowance should be merged with basic pay whenever the DA exceeds 50% of pay. At present, DA is at 59% of pay. The government, having re-examined this recommendation in depth, has therefore decided that DA, to the extent of 50% of pay, will be merged with basic pay. This will take effect from April 1, 2004. Direct taxes, some necessary changes in income tax procedures require the amendment of the Income Tax Act. While changes in the Act are currently not being proposed, it is the conviction of the government, also a commitment, that fiscal benefits available to new projects in the power sector should be extended up to 2012 instead of 2006, and also be available to cases of takeover from state electricity boards. Further, sir, that the regime of listed equities acquired on or after March 1, 2003, being exempt from long-term capital gains tax, should be extended for a further period of 3 years so as to provide stability. More than 90% of the world's shipping tonnage is subject to very, very low levels of taxation. To provide a level playing field so that Indian shipping becomes internationally competitive, a tonnage tax scheme with notional income at a fixed rate on the basis of net registered tonnage should be considered. Farmers face hardships, sir, on account of levy or tax on capital gains and accrued interest on enhanced compensation when their agricultural land is acquired by the government. The government believes that capital gains on such acquisition should be exempt from tax. There should also be no deduction of tax at source on the interest earned on enhanced compensation for acquisition of such land. Business process outsourcing has scope for employment generation. It has been clarified that if outsourced services are ancillary and auxiliary in nature, an adequate remuneration is paid to the Indian call center then there shall be no tax on such foreign company as does outsource its activity to India. This policy is on the lines of OECD norms and double taxation avoidance agreements. It is also the conviction of the government, sir, that for the salaried caste, which doubtless has the best track record of compliance, the issue of revising the standard deduction for income tax purposes has now to be revisited. Furthermore, the tax treatment of family pension or war widows merits a review so as to enable them to live a life of dignity. We also need to revisit the present exemption limits and to realign them appropriately. For indirect taxes, for consolidating the growth process, the government has already announced some measures on January 8. These steps were timely and necessary. I shall not repeat them. For capital goods, to enable our domestic industry to compete with imported capital goods, which are currently subject to a 10% basic customs duty, I have already reduced such duty on a number of raw materials, intermediates, and components for their manufacture. This has removed an anomaly. A suggestion has been made that whenever there is exemption from countervailing duty on an imported capital good, deemed export benefits ought to be given to the very same capital good indigenously manufactured. There already exists a scheme for giving deemed export benefit for specified projects where procurement is through international competitive bidding. Ministry of Finance, in consultation with the Ministry of Commerce, will nevertheless examine this suggestion in order to provide a level playing field to domestic manufacturers. Sir, Power, the Task Force on Power Sector, Investment and Reform has recommended exploring the possibility of making countervailing duty for the power sector sandwichable. This suggestion too will be examined. In the last budget, exemption from excise duty on residual fuel oils for generation of power, available only to units licensed under the Electricity Act of 1910, was extended to generating companies under the Electric Supply Act of 1948. It has been requested that this exemption for units licensed under the 48 Act may now be made applicable retrospectively. Whenever electricity was supplied to state electricity boards and the cost of generation was governed by power purchase agreements, I believe that a suitable legislative measure for retrospective exemption of this nature should be considered. Baggage rules, sir, to further reduce congestion at customs counters in the arrival halls of our international airports, free baggage allowance is being raised from ₹12,000 to ₹25,000. Customs duty on such baggage is also being reduced from 50% to 40%. This will be effective from today. The move towards an improved tax administration through greater application of IT and a discretion-free impersonal system with lower compliance costs must continue. It is with this objective in mind that I'm pleased to announce round-the-clock electronic filing of customers' documents for clearance of goods presently available in 9 customs formations will be extended to 23 customs formations by the 31st of March. Customs clearance will now be based on self-assessment and selective examination from June 30th, an 8-digit code classification of goods for the levy of excise will be adopted by September 30 to bring greater transparency, avoid classification dispute, and harmonize excise classification with customs and exempt policy nomenclature. Further, compounding offences under union excise rules for quick settlement of disputes will be introduced from June 30, and e-filing of excise returns will also be introduced from June 30 to enhance excise automation and for better reconciliation of revenue accounts. For service taxer to enable levy of tax on services as a specific and important source of revenue, an amendment to the Constitution is already in hand. In the interim, the service tax was extended to 7 new services in the last budget. To facilitate the filing of returns and to reduce the compliance costs under this important source of revenue, I'm glad to announce that from January 2, only a simple verification is being made for grant of registration for service tax. That is a single registration and single return for assessees providing more than one taxable service, and service tax automation has been enhanced by extending e-filing of returns and also that electronic scrutiny from 10 services to all the 58 taxable services. I must now, sir, inform the House about the essentials of our bookkeeping for the current year as also for 2004-2005. So the revised estimates show a net decrease in expenditure of rupees 11,143 crore as compared to the budget estimates. This reduction in expenditure has been achieved despite additional expenditure on rural development, on Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, on Delhi Metro Rail Project, and additional budgetary support for the railways. Next, tax revenues for the centre are estimated at rupees 1,87,539 crore compared to the budget estimate of rupees 1,84,169 crore, which is an increase of rupees 3,370 crore. Non-tax revenue is estimated at rupees 75,488 crore, rupees 5,722 crore, more than the estimated level of rupees 69,766 crore. Disinvestment receipts at rupees 14,500 crore are also higher than the budget estimate of rupees 13,200 crore. The revised revenue receipts of the central government are estimated at rupees 2,63,027 crore. The fiscal deficit at rupees 1,32,103 crore, which is 4.8% of the GDP, and the revenue deficit at rupees 99,860 crore, which is 3.6% of the estimated GDP. I trust, sir, that honorable members would observe, and I hope approve of the fact the government has demonstrated it is resolved about fiscal consolidation by performing better than the budgeted targets. In the budget estimates for 2004-2005, the total expenditure is estimated at rupees 4,57,434 crore, of which rupees 1,35,071 crore is for plan, and rupees 3,22,363 crore for non-plan. In order to strike the right balance between developmental needs on the one hand and fiscal stability on the other, the gross budgetary support for plan 2004-05 has been fixed at rupees 1,35,071 crore. This is rupees 14,097 crore more than last year, indicating an increase of 11.6%. Out of this, an amount of rupees 81,367 crore is being provided as budget support for central plan. This is an increase of rupees 9,215 crore or 12.8% over last year. Similarly, central assistance for state plans is rupees 53,704 crore, which is 4,882 crore more than last year. Should need arise for new schemes, as providing urban amenities in rural areas of Pura, the government will then provide additional allocation for such schemes. The budget on non-plan expenditure, sir, the budget estimates for 2004-05 show a net increase of ₹16,218 crore in non-plan expenditure. The increase is mainly in interest payments and debt servicing, defense, grants and loans to state governments, and food subsidy. Mr. Speaker, sir, with these proposals, I estimate total revenue receipts of the center at ₹2,90,882 crore, the fiscal deficit at ₹1,36,452 crore, which is 4.4% of the estimated GDP, and the revenue deficit at ₹89,860 crore, which is 2.9% of the estimated GDP. Sir, I conclude. I had the honor of being given the responsibility of the Ministry of Finance in July 2002. I have served here, sir, for just about a year and a half. During this period, it has been my privilege to see the Indian economy enter onto a sustained and robust growth path of around 7.5 to 8% per year. This has only been possible, sir, because of the reforms pursued by the National Democratic Alliance, as well indeed by earlier governments, of the contribution in this ministry of my distinguished predecessor, Shri Yashwant Sinha, and above all of the support and leadership provided by the Prime Minister Vajpayee. Sir, under the stewardship of Shri Vajpayee, the NDA government in March 1998 has not only successfully weathered the post-Pokhran economic sanctions, East Asian crisis, at least two major destructive cyclones, an unprecedented drought, the devastating Bhuj earthquake, two border standoffs, the challenge of terrorism and insurgency, the Gulf War, the global downturn, uncertainty in oil prices, all these and much else. Despite these multiple challenges, sir, the government during this period brought down the fiscal deficit to 4.8% of GDP, the revenue deficit to 3.6%, and contained annual average inflation at around 4.8%. Our revenue collection in the period 98-2004 has gone up by 83%. Our capital markets are healthy. The unit trust is a market leader again. Our foreign exchange reserves have nearly quadrupled to the never ever achieved level of over $100 billion. Our GDP in this period has increased by almost 40%, and to my belief, sir, national contentment, national confidence, and our collective resolve for achieving even higher growth has now taken firm root. Sir, I commend this interim budget to the House. Thank you.